I suppose when I was about 18, I was just trying to throw myself out everywhere. And I was getting, I had this job just kind of over there actually in Vauxhall, where I used to dance in a bar. And the owner said, right, you can wear whatever you like and just stand there and I want you to freak out Muscle Marys. And I used to get really quite good money for it. So I remember one Monday I was really hungover. I was walking past Jessop's and they had a video camera for like 90 quid. So I just bought it. And then I started making these YouTube clips, which were initially for me to see how my outfits would move. And then I suppose the first proper video I did was in my flat in New Oxford Street, and I couldn't get to sleep. And there's like an NCP car park was behind where I lived, and it shone out quite a lot of light. And I had some yogurt in the fridge, and for some reason I just thought, oh, I'll put a pair of tights on my head, and I'll start putting yogurt on my face. And then I stood up and my towel fell down. And then I started making these weird noises as this character. And then I kind of got into the shower and like took the yogurt off. And then I put it up online because I thought it was just quite funny. And then it got like 5,000 hits. And people were like, oh my God, you're fat gay, or oh my God, this is fantastic. I suppose it made me feel like, oh, there are other people out there who are a bit weird. I hadn't been to university and I haven't had that forum to put work out there and get critiques. I suppose it was like the layman's version of getting a crit, or just kind of getting people to react to your work and then knowing what was good and what worked. So it was, YouTube was my university, I suppose. And I was excited to put stills on Flickr and to put short clips on YouTube because I thought, I'm instantly going to start to get responses from this, and I'll instantly find out what people think about it. And so it felt exciting because it worked with my aesthetic of being lo-fi and work being accessible. I was quite anti-art school and anti-establishment, I suppose. I wanted my work to be free, and I wanted people to say what they felt about it, and then I kind of encouraged kind of criticism and in the public forum.
What sort of feedback did you get?
Oh, you get the usual, like people think you're really weird, and you get the usual homophobia or transphobia. But I never used to look down at it. I thought, well, now they've seen something like that. You know, if they see a kid in their town who looks slightly weird, they'll think, oh, well, it's just another one of those, you know, people. Never trust a man in a wig. The whole concept of the DVD was that each film had to be made and edited in 24 hours. When I'm using film, I largely point and shoot, and touch wood, it kind of works for me. I think film really lends to improvisation, where I think the stage, it just becomes a bit like, oh, we're out of work comedians. I think film really kind of lends to this idea of, I'm looking for a better, more working class word than organic. It's just a bit, it's a bit easier to kind of go, all right, what about this idea, let's chuck it in. Because I went to a Catholic school, we had these like stories which were told to us, which would be like, I don't know, maybe the Catholic Church sent them out. But sometimes they'd come with like videos, like VHSs and these kind of big wheelie tellies. And they'd be like, you know, like girls licking bits of paper with strawberries on it. And then all of a sudden they'd become really dizzy. And then like the moral of the story was, don't take drugs, be a Catholic. And sometimes they were really quite dark about like people dying of hunger, and you're sat next door and you're eating, and they'd be quite like, and make you feel really guilty as a child for like being able to eat. In a lot of my film work, I have used food because I think it looks fantastic on film, and we're quite used to being fed these television programs where food, there's, you know, food is quite a big chunk of our television network, and it's about subverting that form and moralizing what that can mean. In XXX, that's a film that I eroticize food, but in a quite subversive manner, where, because, you know, like, couples experiment with chocolate, I kind of experiment with melons and what the, how they can be subverted. In Betty Part 2, that's, you know, more about the physical, about food, about how she overindulges, and that's to her detriment, and how she feels about her body.
Time for our third guest star now, and we are spoiling you tonight.
I got a telephone call from a friend who had been to dinner with Rihanna's people, and they had asked if there were any people in London who they should have on the X Factor performance.
Please welcome to the X Factor, Rihanna.
And she asked them what the show was, and they said, well, we have this idea that there's a banquet. And so she said, if you're doing anything with food, you have to do something with Scottee. Yeah. And so I got a phone call I thought was very bizarre, and I turned up and she was there, and she asked, she said, are you Scottee? And I said, yeah. She said, I think I've seen your pictures, you look fantastic. Let's have a cake fight. Like I'm the only one that you'll ever love. So we decided to have a cake fight, and we orchestrated it with her performers. And I suppose the same things comes back from if you're doing the cabaret venue to if you're doing the X Factor. People don't want you to make a mess. People are really anti-mess. And, you know, we got in quite a lot of trouble because I literally covered the whole of the X Factor studio in cream.
What have you done? What have you done to our stage? Are you gonna hang around and
clean
this up?
They're getting loud. They're getting loud with the food.
When you do that kind of work on primetime ITV, you know, other people may go, oh, no, more than that. But I think that's great that your work can communicate to such a mass market. I think it'd be different if I kind of came on and I wasn't wearing a dress and they'd try to make me look normal and I wasn't really doing my work. But the fact it was literally my work on the X Factor was great. People ask me that question all the time. People always say to me, you should be on the television, you. As if that's the holy grail of one's career. Be on the television, because and my grandfather and my grandmother always say Paul O'Grady shit, and I don't know why you're not in his place, and that makes me laugh that people who you know, don't know about my work reference television as being the marking point of your career. And I think I've got lots of friends who are performers who aspire to be on the television. I don't think I've ever aspired to be on the television or want to be on the television. I just think it probably happened at some time.